Recording now. This is the pod management and VOLTHA FCAPS Brigade for August 26th. This meeting is recorded. We do make these recordings available online, so this should be considered a public meeting. Welcome, everyone. On the agenda today, I've put down three items. The first will be status reports, then an update on the OLT vendor survey that I've been working on. And then if we have time and people are interested in participating, maybe a short discussion on KPI formats. Let me see if we have Ankar. Yes, we have Ankar. So Ankar, let's start with you on status reports.
Yeah, sure. Hi all. So basically I'm like writing some code about the gRPC implementation of starting OMCI action. So like I have in between like writing the code, and one thing I just wanted to understand, where if I load the adapter from the consider like the ONU ID, so will that be get called directly from the Kafka invoke RPC mechanism? Will that be directly get called to the Broadcom, for example, ONU adapter? Or is there a way we need to call first OpenOLT adapter, and then from there it will invoke the ONU adapter? Because in previous 1.7 implementation, we have full privilege of calling the ONU adapters directly from the adapter base class. So that point I'm trying to figure it out currently.
Yeah, I might need some time to digest those implementation details and look into them. So, I mean, my understanding is usually to talk to the ONU, you talk via the OLT. I guess you're asking about the control plane connection to talk to the ONU adapter. I would think you could do that. Does anyone know?
So maybe I'll look into it and I can explain you. I'm in between that also. So while doing the coding and looking into the code, so I can understand. So maybe if I can get anything, I'll definitely share with you guys.
Sure. And if we want to, we can bring it up with the group. Okay.
Yeah.
That sounds good. Any other status?
Nothing from my side.
Okay. Ganesh, how about a status on what you're working at?
Yes, I was working on retrieving the optical parameters from OLT. I have gone through the previous discussions, previous design approaches. Basically, after a few comments from various people, I realized that we want to retrieve this data on Redfish, and I discussed with Dinesh from HCore. And he has given me the details about how importer is working right now, and there are a few documented links he shared. So I understand that most of the data what we want is getting retrieved on Redfish importer. So I was working with installing building the Redfish server and installing on my setup so that I can fire some commands to see how we retrieve. That's the standard format. So that's where I was doing something. But it seems like we really don't need so much.
I think we temporarily lost Ganesh.
I was on mute. Scott, one thing I was, remind us what Ganesh is doing. I mean, why does it require Redfish?
So he's working on the optical data from the OLT. This would be things like optical power levels, temperatures. I'd have to pull up the JIRA item to see I don't have the chair item handy.
I'm wondering why, because you know that those are the I'm wondering why that status going through the refish or not.
You know, yeah, so I have a list of the items here. So OLT, receive and transmit, optical signal levels, OLT, module temperatures and voltages, and laser bias current. So we have Dinesh here, and Dinesh, Ganesh said that most of this was available in Redfish. So could you answer Sean's question as to why we've decided to do this data through Redfish as opposed to doing it through some other mechanism?
Or just put it on KPI and on the Kafka, right? Just like the ONU status.
Yeah, I actually don't know why it was decided. Means Redfish collects the data. Maybe that is the reason that we don't want to duplicate this data collection through any other firm. So maybe that's why he's trying to get the data from Redfish.
Yeah, one reason you may want to do it through Redfish and not something specific to the OLT is, you know, Redfish is supported by not only the OLTs, but by the switches that make up the Trellis environment, but also on the server nodes as well as a standard. So in theory, you know, you may want to get this type of optical information, low-level optical information from any of your plugins that's in your SIBA pod infrastructure.
Okay. But what if, what if, right? What if some OLT does not support Redfish?
Shame on them.
Okay, let's make that a requirement. Well, how about Tibet? Tibet, you know, that little plug doesn't have support Redfish, right? So, but they still have optical power and then, you know, bias related reading, right?
If you plug that Tibet thing in a switch that supported Redfish, you'd get that information on the plugin, because the switch would just see it as a standard SFP plugin and provide that information. You know, that's assuming Tibet follows the MSA guidelines for that I squared C information.
Yeah, that's correct. I believe it does. But we also can, within the adapter, we can actually query, you know, temperatures and optical power readings and such as well.
Okay.
Within the OLT device itself. So.
Too bad. Is it Ganesh came back? Hopefully his family is okay. That's pretty dramatic.
Yeah, I'm sure everything is fine. But we'll see if he comes back later in the meeting.
Is anybody from Sterlite maybe check he's okay? No, I'm fine. I just want to make sure, you know, whether they'll become a dependency for, you know, Redfish or not, right? So whether that's a good dependency or it's some dependency is not required.
Is it Redfish, can we say, is like the adapter function to get to the information in this case, and it does come with a lot of standardization. I remember seeing the proposals in the April timeframe, and I remember our discussions on SIBA dev about it. So Sean, that's what we have. There's information about retrieving to the SFP because the SFP is standardized in a Redfish implementation. So that's, there was a doc SFP info retrieval design approach. Dinesh was asking for feedback. And Ganesh was involved as well. And we had a few email exchanges on it. Some was related to the requirements of the retrievals themselves. Associated to that, when you go to an ONU, which is a different case, we had similar discussions as well, but that was where OMCI was involved.
Okay. Well, Tom, you have an impeccable memory. Okay, let me dig that out. I just, yeah, okay. If we have discussed that, then I think I'm okay.
Okay, any more discussion on the choice of redfish over over alternatives? If not,
the question is, if someone, I think that's probably the same mechanism for any parameter supported, right? So if the northbound system want to query the optical power, then do they get the data from the redfish or from the Kafka or from the device adapter?
So we're going to have the Kafka exporter, or the Kafka topic exporter, that'll pull redfish periodically and push to Kafka. So if someone northbound wants to get data that we have already collected, it'll be there on Kafka for them. I guess you could ask, what if someone wants, you know, to do an immediate query?
Real time.
Yeah, real time query. Do they go to redfish directly? I would think I would think that's what they would do if they needed immediate information, go to redfish directly, because we don't, otherwise we'd have to develop an alternative API. Any other thoughts on that?
Yeah, I really would like to hear the community's response on this one.
Yes, don't develop another API.
Okay. No, I would say the API will be the same, but whether the target of the API, is there such thing as a difference?
If we have a mechanism to get the information, I don't think we should create another mechanism to get the information.
Yeah, I think I agree with David on this. If we have redfish, redfish does what we want. Redfish is standardized and supported by the devices we're interested in. Redfish supports an immediate query. If someone wants to make an immediate query, they can use redfish rather than us inventing our own just to have our own brand name on it. So I guess I would be in line with David's thoughts on this, but does anyone have an opinion to the contrary?
Well, I mean for the Tibbit adapter, we're within the Tibbit device. We will not be supporting redfish on that, as far as I know. So if it's available from the switch that we're contained in, then that would probably meet your with redfish, that would meet your needs. But otherwise, if you don't have a compliant switch, it'd be available off a Kafka KPI bus probably.
So for Tibbit, you'd be directly publishing to Kafka then?
That would be quite simple. I mean, for some of the information that might be needed.
And then if someone...
How is that information being configured as to what the adapter or the device is actually publishing on Kafka?
Right now we're just publishing the NNI and the port statistics, but we also go down and get much of the power levels and temporarily just right now we're using that as part of our heartbeat. So we would have to add it as a KPI group if it's not already in one. The alternative is we have to implement a redfish container that we talk to fake things, and that's getting pretty ugly.
Well, I mean, there's going to have to be an API down to the ONU at this point to say what groups I want to publish in Kafka. Yes.
Oh, I mean, you mean on the OLT or the ONU?
Okay. I mean, well, for the Tibbit device, how do you tell it what to publish, right? Yeah, you can create a new group to also include this information, but you want to be able to control when and how much, you know, the volume, if you will. I want these groups of KPIs versus those groups of KPIs. There's got to be a management API for that, yeah? yes?
Yeah, there's already a simple one in the KP, in the performance, in the PM.
Collection.
API, in the PM API, but it's just not really as tunable as I think as you probably might need.
Okay, so I found that email, Tom, you mentioned. There's proposals history there. So Scott, I think there were originally two proposals on the attachment. Is everything still up to date, or we may need to update this status of this?
So you're talking about the what did I do with it? The wall clock API proposal?
No. This is about the Redfish directly.
Oh, about the Redfish.
Right. Back to April. I'm just wondering whether the proposal is still up to date.
Yeah, if you could link that to the email thread, maybe that would be good, and we could all review it.
I just reply all. So it should show up on the VOLTHA Discuss and then SIBA Discuss right now.
Okay, great. Yeah, I see device management proposal for review.
And then if we finalize it, then let's finalize it.
Yeah, let's get it finalized if we've all agreed on it. But yeah, that'd be good. Let's see, I'm looking at your email now. Reminder of the email. I'm not finding the proposal itself. I'm seeing a reminder about the proposal.
Oh. You go all the way up, would that still be there?
Oh, all the way. Oh, so at the beginning of the thread. Yeah, right. Okay, yeah, there's attachments on the thread. Yeah, let's, everyone interested in this topic, let's please see that thread that Sean just bumped and look at those documents and make sure we all agree on which way we're going with that.
Okay, great, thanks. So Tom, you know, based on AT&T's position, we agree, right? Some aspects. Okay, thank you. Sorry for the interrupt.
No, it was great. Any other discussion on this point? Well, okay, let's move along with the status from Dinesh on, I think you guys were working toward doing a demo.
Yeah, so I have some issue with the VPN tunneling to the device. So once that the IT at H-Core is working on it, once they resolve the thing, then I will check the event management. Events get generated by the device, and then I can do the demo. So right now, the VR collection works.
Dinesh.
Yeah,
check your email. They send an email out saying that it's resolved. Check the message from Fred Lai.
Okay, I'll test it today then.
Thank you.
So if the VPN is no issue, then potentially Scott, Julie, we're thinking to put this on Thursday, right?
Yes, she already has put it.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Okay, does anyone else have any more status-related things to talk about?
Scott, I'm sorry I got abruptly disconnected. I was in between, so shall I, can I take 1 minute to summarize?
Sure, absolutely, go ahead.
So basically I was building a Redfish service to test locally, and I spoke with Dinesh and someone from H-Core if they find, I stuck at one point. So I have started, I have built and installed all the packages, but still the service was not coming up. Tomorrow I will explore, and if I get some help from Dinesh or somebody from his team, so that will be good. Otherwise, I'll continue on exploring and fixing that issue. So rest, that's all fine for me to continue on testing some of the APIs on Redfish. And the second thing I thought of is we need to have command line interface also, APIs to call. So I'll go through the code for VOLTHA 2.0. So I'm just exploring. It's new. I have installed. So I'll come up with something next week.
So a command line interface to do what?
To retrieve the parameters, like Omkar is working on from retrieving the parameters from ONU on ONCI channel. And this will be for the parameters to retrieve on OLT, on the Redfish.
So you'd be looking at a CLI that talks to Redfish directly?
Yeah, that's the plan. But for now, I'm going into VOLTHA 2.0 setup and understanding some code flow. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because
okay, great.
Is that true? Because most of the development done we have so far is all against the VOLTHA 1.7, right, or 1.6. Have we tried on the VOLTHA 2.0 yet?
For me, this is completely new thing since Redfish is already there. So I'm planning to first hit the APIs and get the result so that I can validate what all we want. We are getting it.
Okay.
And the next thing would be if at all we want APIs, the command line interface. So that's what the next plan would be probably, and that we will do on two.
Okay, great. So we'll probably talk next week about what you've discovered and what you propose on implementing.
Yes, Scott. Yes.
Okay. Sounds good.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else, Ganesh?
No, that's all for now. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, well, I'm going to take presentation and share what I've learned from OLT vendors. Okay, so everyone can see my screen, which currently has survey of devices.
Yes.
So we've contacted these vendors. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 8 of them total. A few of them were still waiting to hear back, so we're waiting to hear back from Calix. I think Taskin was going to take the lead on EdgeCore, and then we're waiting to hear back from Nokia. But the other ones we've had responses from. The responses they vary from just short yes no's to my questions to complex answers that explain all of the nuance about the answer. So I've kind of tried to summarize and digest it down in here. So Adtran, I talked to Andy Rubel. He says, yes, it does. Well, let me step back. The question we're trying to answer is whether the devices do support 15-minute interval statistics from the device. So there were a series of questions here that I asked. Do they support the interval statistics? Can we fetch the current and at least one prior interval? Is the interval configurable? Is the API documented? And can the API be made to conform to something of the VOLTHA team's choosing? So Andy Rubel, for the first three questions, confirmed yes to all of those. So the AdTrans do support the interval statistics. CIG does not currently support it. So they were assuming it would be accumulated in VOLTHA or above. So sort of assuming David's model, I believe. But they believe they did have the resources to implement it in the driver if they wanted to. EdgeCore, Taskin was going to take the lead on that. Let me see if we have
No, I haven't said anything. I'll try to get it up today.
Okay, no problem. Iskratel, we heard back. It does not, they do not do it at this time, but they are able to dedicate resources to do it. They would be interested in supporting current and last intervals. They'd be able to do a configurable interval if we wanted. Tellab supports 15-minute current and last buckets on ponds and a rolling and 15-minute utilization for NNI. I need to clarify whether they do last bucket on NNI. I was kind of assuming so, but I want to query that or want to confirm that. The interval itself is not configurable, but they thought they could do it. Their current API is SNMP based, and they would align with the VOLTHA API. So Tibit does not support the interval query directly. They support kind of the alignment and streaming metrics, sort of what we've outlined in this proposal. So they can align their streams to a 15-minute bucket, and we would collect them inside the time series database. So Chip, since I have you here, if I could fill out the second spot here in this box, which is, would it be feasible for Tibit to support the 15-minute last interval query directly on the device? I'm assuming not, but I wanted to ask you before I put in a no answer.
Well, I could very easily provide it from the Tibit device adapter. I mean, that's a very simple programming exercise.
Okay, great.
So, I mean, that's very simple for me.
Yeah, so I've started. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I had a question for you. I'll scroll back up to the ADTRAN response. So you have a note there that it's for the series, not the one used by VOLTHA. So is the yes below that for the VOLTHA OLT?
Yeah, that is for the one used by VOLTHA.
Okay, so just the first line is for the non-VOLTHA one. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and I think we can delete this first line, so since that one is not interested to us. That was just what Chip had experience with that first OLT, so that was one of our first data points.
Yeah, I was pretty positive the one UOLT supported it. I just didn't want to go out on a limb and promise it.
Okay, so I'm attempting to put all of these in a table. Just so we can digest it down to one picture. So far, it's looking like everyone we've talked to either already supports it or does not support it, but would be willing to support it. So I don't think we have Michael on the call, but I think Michael was the one most interested in this information because it does lend support to being able to do this at the device or device adapter level. That people do either support it or are willing to support it. So I guess the question is, where do we go from here?
Before we do that, I have a question is, maybe Chip and others can chime in. Just something, if someone pulled the current, the northbound system, well, the 15 minutes, that's automatically just keep doing that, right? And yeah. if someone or the operation come in to pull the current data, the current counter, and on that pull they also enable reset, so all the counter become zero, will that affect the 15 minutes collection?
No, typically, I mean, most of the 15-minute intervals came from some of the standard IETF MIBs, and that pull of the current data does not clear the counters. So if you did a pull, say on the interface stats, you'd get the counters. You did a second later, you get the counters plus the new bytes. So you're not clearing the hardware. You're just getting the current status since the start of the interval.
But there is an option to reset, right? There is an option to reset it.
This is
more general question. I'm just curious about that, right? So if someone pulled, and I know the BAL has options that after you retrieve it, you can reset it to.
Yeah, in the legacy access networks, that was more of a proprietary feature. because okay. the 15 minute intervals were always you usually didn't want to reset counters unless on the hardware.
No, or the way, or potentially, because instead of operation, right? I come in, I retrieve the current counter, and 5 seconds later, I retrieve another current counter. Instead of I do a calculation myself, I reset. Maybe I issue a counter, I issue comment to reset it, and then I pull the counter after 5 minutes, right? So there is some kind of operational purpose to reset the counter. Whether that's standardized or not, that can be debatable, right? So that's one of the interesting use cases. I just don't know whether if everything got reset, if the physical counter got reset, then that will affect the accumulated counter for everything else. I'm just wondering.
Yeah, and I would think the only reason operations would want to reset counters is if the counter width was too small for the speed. But I would hope that most people are running 64-bit counters for at least frames and octets on a 10 gig network. So,
yeah, again, or the operation easy, right? Yeah. So I don't have to put a calculator and then visually see.
Usually the GUI will do that for you.
So that's an EMS. A lot of it's an EMS function,
yeah,
right?
If you want it to be standardized, then that's a really good EMS function.
Okay. So which bring up just the fundamental question, which may against what Michael was thinking about, anything EMS related, it's all northbound of the device, right? Yeah. So interesting. Okay, I just a thought. Okay, Scott, back to you.
Sure. So I'm going to ask you a question, Sean. I was putting a survey to ask operators these three questions. Alexa just responded to me. Weird. Who knows? She's listening to everything. Anyway, these three proposed questions.
Does she support 15-minute buckets?
I'm not going to ask her because then she'll tell me and I won't be able to shut her up. Okay, she didn't start playing music or something. Anyway, these three questions are what I was thinking we could send to DT and TT. Is it required for your use case that statistics be collected in 15-minute intervals aligned with the wall clock? Is there any interval other than 15 minutes that would be more appropriate? If collecting intervals is not the requirement, so if the answer to the top question was no, then is reporting streaming statistics such as every 15 seconds without alignment to the wall clock necessarily, would that be sufficient? So I was thinking we could send those three questions to our operators, and
I think Bjorn is on the call right now. I think Bjorn is I think based on last time we discussed it, the Deutsche Telekom is bringing the question in the proposal internally. It will be under review. Bjorn, do you want to mention it? Bjorn, we cannot hear you. Okay. I think the status Bjorn provided last time is they are looking at all the stuff you have proposed now. So internally.
Okay, great. Yeah, I think I remember that mentioned on one of last week's VOLTHA calls. So, I'll attach Bjorn's name to this, and we'll get that filled in once we hear back on that. We should contact Turk Telecom as well.
Yes.
And Sean, you and I can coordinate contact info on that, or if we have someone on the VOLTHA call, we can ask them during the call.
Right. And for the members like Sterlite and then Furukawa, if you have other, you know, service provider working with you, I think, you know, if that definitely something they're interested in SIBA, the more service provider we can serve it, that's the better. And Bjorn just say
Sean, let me take a look here in Brazil with some operators.
That'll be great. I mean, but okay, so Scott, of course, you know, I we don't delay your answer, so let's collect the AT&T, DT, Turk Telecom NTT first, and then the other members from this community can reach out to their service provider, their potential service providers.
Sure, that sounds great. The more info we can get and the broader audience we can have, the better.
Yes.
Yeah, I would like to get this proposal to a close relatively soon. It feels like we've been discussing it for a while, but I think we have already collected a lot of data. I don't know if any of this has altered. We don't have Michael here, but we do have David here. If any of this has altered your fundamental opinion on it, David, that it does seem like lots of vendors are willing to support collecting this at the device level. Does that influence your opinion on? No, okay.
My opinion is, can we just move forward and be done with this?
Yep.
I honestly think 15, you know, if you guys want to collect 50-minute buckets, great, collect 50-minute buckets, as long as we can also get more streaming data, because I believe 50-minute bucket will be the maybe what people are doing today in some of the operators. I don't think it's forward-looking. And so I think we need streaming metrics for forward-looking data analysis. Mm-hmm. So again, I'm not against buckets. But if you don't have the other one, I think you're going to box yourself in for the future.
This is Tom from AT&T. I will respond to this as well, but I agree with what David's saying, and I've provided some responses. I mean, some discussion around this, but let me put something in writing, which I think accomplishes that and our goals for 15 minutes. And it's related to the data that we need. What I've said before is that if we're sampling at smaller intervals, we get the precise start and stop timestamps, then you can derive everything you need to know for whatever goal. And I'll provide an example of how we use that northbound of SIBA as well.
Great.
Yeah, that sounds great. So maybe a goal for getting this, trying to get to the end of this proposal is next week's call?
Yes, that's a good goal. One thing I'd note is next Monday is Labor Day holiday in U.S., but the goal would be to respond this week. So you have it in writing this week. That way we meet that, you know, we do meet the spirit of by next week.
Yeah, so thank you for pointing that out. So next Monday's call will be canceled. It's going to be hard to reschedule during the week just because our mornings are already so full of other meetings. I'll look at some slots, think about whether we want to try to have a call at another time, or we could just, If we have topics that are ready for a VOLTHA call, we could talk there. But I will make a note and I will inform everyone that Monday's call is canceled. Let's try to wrap this up. Well, let's try to get it wrapped up before ONF Connect. That's 2 weeks' time, but I mean, let's shoot for getting it wrapped up this week and next. Everyone.
Yeah, but at ONF Connect, this one is not one of the topics we need to provide update, right? It'd be nice.
No, it just seemed like a good deadline because
yes,
everyone's attention is going to be shifted to ONF Connect, and we're going to be busy with that for a week, and we're going to lose traction on something like this with everything else we're doing. So,
yeah, okay.
try to get to the bottom of this. You know, I kind of agree with David's approach of let's try to be forward thinking. But I think I also agree with, you know, Michael's approach of if someone, and I think David agrees with this too, if someone provides us the buckets, let's push the buckets on through so that, I mean, let's not throw away a feature that someone's providing us already. But maybe the least common denominator we should strive for would be streaming statistics.
Yeah, the question is going to be, do the buckets become part of the abstraction API? And if that's fine, as long as we have the other API, you know, the more streaming data as well. It just means for those vendors that promised or said they're willing to do support, the minute we say it's part of the abstraction API, we're going to have to rely on that promise to go actually implement it. You know, at this point, I'm like, I don't know what's holding up the decision at this point. If it's me saying, can we do buckets in the adapter? Great. Do buckets in the adapter. Can we just move on as long as we have streaming? I mean, I don't know what the holdup is at this point.
Yeah, I would be fine with that position.
What are we hoping to gain in another week that we don't already know now?
So can we make a decision now? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, what's holding us? What information are we lacking that is stopping us from making a decision right now?
I think your decision is your suggestion is compatible with everything that everyone wants, which is basically sort of support both with the buckets being sort of an optional component. So,
well, if they're not optional at that point, because they wanted them in the abstraction API, such that northbound of Volta, you basically say, I want the buckets. And Volta provides them, and the device data comes from the device. So the question is, does the 15-minute interval bucket become part of the abstraction API? And do we believe any, you know, what information are we waiting for to make that decision, I guess, that we expect to get in the next week that we don't have now? Because I'm not sure we're going to, in what we, you know, the data that we went over, I don't see what we're waiting for to make that decision. I don't see, you know, oh, there's one deciding factor that'll call that. Or can we just say, hey, look, great, we'll make it part of the adapter interface or the abstraction interface, which means those devices that don't support it will either have to support it or support it in their adapter. And now that's part of Volta. Again, my only concern is I also think we have to be forward looking and beyond the 15-minute interval buckets. We are also going to want to be able to provide streaming metrics or less than 15-minute interval metrics so that we can do more machine learning, more streaming analytics, whatever you want to call it. That's my only concern. So if we don't think there's any new information that is we're going to see in the next week that's going to drastically change anything, can we just call the question?
Yeah, look, here's David. This is Tom Moore. Let me – I agree with what you're saying. I'm for what you're saying. What I want to do in a follow-up is to provide some references to where this is being done already. When we, as far as some northbound implementation, so that we can put some terminology around it for what goes into the use cases. So that's really truly what I was intending to do to illustrate toward the goal that you're saying as well.
Okay. So, I mean, if we believe that that's going to be helpful for the next week, that's great. Let's do that. I have no objection. I'm kind of where Scott was saying, you know, we've been discussing this a long time. I just feel like we're almost rat-holing in some places.
So the thing is, where I'm at on this is the solution supporting this needs to be flexible towards any implementation. You know, decisions on what we implement now above where the SIVA implementation ends. Do have some input on this, but it's not going to change the way the SIVA implementation does it accept for making sure that we have a way, like I'd said before, to know what the timestamps are. And I'll show where that needs to flow through from that. So, okay. So that's all I'm saying is it's so that we can put this into implementation view beyond this. So it doesn't, I don't think it changes what has been collected so much in some presentations, other than let's put some terminology around it, some of the data definition around it, and go from there. I just want to make sure if I we can't achieve this correctly without having the timestamp generation to say, oh, I'm looking at this sample, which is the streaming sample, or I'm going to take streaming samples and I'm going to convert them into a larger interval. There's a whole concept for this with data definition. It's pretty straightforward. Just want to formalize it and say, okay, that's we'll take care of what's underneath the covers and what's it, and how we externalize it as well.
Okay, sounds good.
So Tom, we could take whatever your output is and incorporate it into this document.
Yeah, I'm working on something related to this now, so it's non-problem, it's good timing.
Okay, good. So let's plan on trying to get all of this put together this week, and then as soon as it's put together, we'll talk to Julie and try to get it in a VOLTHA call, and we will frame what we've come up with as a decision, looking for people to either support or object that decision, and hopefully everyone will support it. Does that sound good?
Yes.
Does that sound good to you, David? Okay, so are we ready to move on from this item?
Yes.
Okay, so one thing, we only have about 10 minutes left, but I did want to talk about something that came up, and I forget whether it was Ankar or Ganesh. It was one of you guys pointing out that you were seeing KPIs in binary encoded Kafka, and that representation is encoded using protobufs. We've had some discussion kind of informally between, you know, me and someone else like David here and there, about whether it might be much more convenient if that format was just plain ordinary JSON. So I did want to kick off a discussion on that. I'm not sure if we have all of the participants that we need here on the call, but maybe just some preliminary discussion on that. I think it would be handy for northbound consumers if that was plain ordinary JSON and they didn't need to build themselves a protobuf over Kafka decoder for it. Any other opinions on this?
Yeah, I think I too agree on the same thing. Like, we should have JSON instead of that encoded messages, because while decoding it, we do need a protobuf at the northbound side. So by using plain JSON, that would help.
So I'm kind of in favor of JSON. Ankar, you're in favor of JSON. I think, David, from previous conversation, you're in favor of JSON.
I'm in favor of JSON mostly because I think most northbound tools support JSON where they don't support protobuf, although I think Ken mentioned that Elastic actually has a protobuf plugin now. So that may be changing, but I'm not sure it's changed enough.
Right.
To say that we have, you know, protobuf's the way to go. So I think JSON probably has more wider acceptability right now. At some point in the future, we may also want to publish protobuf, but for now, I think JSON's good.
So who would be the proponents of, I assume this was discussed at the lockdown or something, and someone decided in favor of doing the protobuf encoding. Who would be the people we need to involve in the discussion? Who would be advocates of doing it in protobuf?
Maybe we just hit the discuss list again and see if there's an advocate for it, or if we can just conclude that way. I mean, yeah. Protobuf might have been done just from ease of use, right? They already had the protobuf there.
Yeah. I certainly understand.
The other solution.
Go ahead.
The other solution, of course, is continue the protobuf Kafka bus and just put another component out there that does protobuf to X, where X could be anything. But then you've got a double transmission of each event.
Yeah, I kind of agree with you there. And I start to wonder what we're saving in performance if we've just introduced a component that has to read everything in protobuf and convert it back out to JSON.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so I would be in favor of not introducing yet another translator proxy type thing. So yeah, let's for next step on this, let's bring this to the VOLTHA discuss list. So I will make a action item on that, because I think it is at least in the immediate future going to hamper some of our northbound integration efforts to have this in JSON or to have this in protobuf, and then you know people would have to build specialty decoders if they don't exist. Whereas JSON, like you say, everyone can speak JSON. Any other discussion on this from people on the call? Okay, I will move forward with the action item of getting that out on the VOLTHA discuss list. Any other brigade business to discuss this morning? Well, I think we're ready to wrap up. Thank you everyone for your opinions, and I look forward to us being able to close out this wall clock API proposal soon.
And maybe Scott, once we've done that, we can have an overall view regarding to how, at least on the alarm reporting and then PM releases, what have we established so far? I think is that true? The alarm portion, we have not spent a lot of time discussing it, right?
Yeah, I think technically the alarm and event handling was supposed to be another brigade someplace, or at least another work item. I know Zach was working on it, but I would have to query him and see if there is a brigade active on that or whether it's fallen under our umbrella.
I think potentially, I think there was a document created for that, right? But
yeah.
I believe, and David was leading that effort, and
there was a document basically that said, you know, the core difference between alarms and events, where alarms were a persistent state that you could query, and events are essentially documenting, if you will, a state transition, and that's kind of where that left. And so we had gone down to the point of, okay, let's make sure everything is sent off the device or out of VOLTHA, if you will, as an event. So we would send an event when we transition from, you know, one state to another or whatever anything was. So the things on the wire were all events. And then if you wanted to query a state, that becomes a separate API, like a Redfish API. Go give me the state of something, right? That's a persistent variable. But on the wire, we would be doing events, and you would get straight state transition events as well as other events from the system.
So what I suggest, maybe we should have there's no separate brigade, you know, the document was created, but I think maybe we can put a summary on this brigade and then have everything coming together. One other thing is AT&T internally, we did do a Nexus scan of the SIBA framework. So there is a scanned report, but at the same time, right now, I don't know whether it's something we can share with the community yet. But if, you know, so what I'm saying is that may address some of the security related stuff. So that should be part of the FCAPS also. And then, okay, so I just hoping, you know, maybe at some point we can have what we have established, and you know, at least on the framework definition, all that kind of stuff, and you know, and then we can have an overview of that.
Yeah, I agree with you, Sean. Let's try to produce some output that reflects our many months of decision making and deep diving here, and get that summary out to the community where people can see what we've come up with, and then we're actually going to have to start implementing something.
Exactly.
Yeah. And that, do you have an output or a summary, whatever you call it, at ONF Connect, a slot for that for this brigade?
We do not, at least not one that I'm involved in.
We do not. I wonder if a suggestion would be do a 15 minutes, you know, 10 to 15 minutes on each brigade, you know, just so everybody can figure out what the brigades are doing, kind of informational summary thing. Just walk through all 10 or whatever number of brigades there are. Each gets 5 to 10 minutes or whatever.
It may be a little bit too late. I think that we don't have that scheduled for that. Let's take a look of the schedule. Potentially, you know, if there's something we can squeeze something in, I'll take a look of that. Okay.
Yeah, I can pass that request. I can pass that request up the channel too and see. But I too worry that there is not time allocated to it. But it would be very useful, David. I agree.
Yeah. And then
you could always do it over a lunch or something too, right? Yeah. During the lunch sessions and just do it something like that.
Right. Maybe early gathering, something like that. Yeah. Okay. I think the VOLTHA status is on the Wednesday afternoon, right? That's all VOLTHA related. The first half of the Wednesday afternoon. Okay. Did someone else trying to say? I heard.
No, I think we're good, and we'll look over the schedule and see what we can do. Okay. We're at the top of the hour.
And just remind people, I send out the survey regarding to face-to-face during the VOLTHA ONF Connect. If you have not responded, please respond. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Scott.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. And I'll get back to you on whether we're going to try to reschedule next week. I'm thinking probably not, but we'll see.
Well, we can steal some of Julie's time if we can.
Yeah, we could steal some VOLTHA call time if there's time.
Okay. That'll be next week.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks, everyone, and talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye.
Guys.